back to the AZAPO online series, and we are here on this day, the 54th anniversary of the founding of our movement. I am here to converse about the significance and the importance of this day. I am here with the president of the Azanian People's Organization, Comrade Nelvis Qekema. Welcome to the AZAPO online. I am also here with the former presidents of the Azanian People's Organization, in Comrade Mosibudi Mangena, Comrade Strike Thokoane, and Comrade Pandelani Nefolovhodwe. Welcome to this platform, comrades.
Thank you. Thank you, my child.
No, thank you. This is a very significant day, Comrade President Qekema, to the history of the Azanian People's Organization, to the history of the Black Consciousness Movement. You heard the starting song. It says, Mabawiyeke umhlaba wethu sikhalela izwe lethu. We have been crying for our land. We have been crying for our nationhood. We have been crying for our dignity. 54 years is a very long time. What do you put this to? How significant this moment is to the Azanian Revolution?
Thank you, Chair. It is indeed a very poignant moment. It's a moment that we receive with mixed feelings, happy and sad at the very same time. Sad because, as you could listen to the song is saying, let them leave our land alone. But we were also saying, let them leave our leaders alone, because the Black Consciousness Movement, unlike many other organizations, we really had our leaders killed. That was the time when we had lost around about 1972 to Libashezi, because he was fighting for the rights of our Black women who were being abused, you know, by a racist railway policeman in Jimestin, and then he was pushed onto an oncoming train and we lost him. And then in 1974, we lost Onkhopotse Tiro, you know, mutilated by a parcel bomb. And then 1975, we lost Mapetla Mohapi in prison. Then in 1977, then we lost our father, Bantu Biko. And then it is only on the 19th of October that the organizations of the Black Consciousness Movement were banned. When those organizations were banned, you would see why we sang this song, because this song has a significance as well of saying, let them leave our organizations alone. Mabayeke inhlangano zethu. And armed with that attitude, as the Black Consciousness Movement, we were agreed that we're not going to follow, you know, the line of the older liberation movements, that when they were banned, they were going to not do much, but demand that they be unbanned or recognized. But we were saying, no. We were going to continue with the struggle as if nothing had happened. That is the reason why only 6 months later, after the banning of the Black Consciousness Movement organizations on the 19th of October, we were able to reconstitute the banned organization into AZAPO on the 12th of April, 1978. Sorry, 28 April, 1978. So in that regard, you would see, therefore, the significance of the 28th April is very, very, very important in the history of the Black Consciousness Movement, because The 28th of April represents the reconstitution of the Black Consciousness Movement into AZAPO. 28th of April represents the continuation of the struggle and the movements that the enemy sought to kill and destroy. 28th of April represents the defiance of the spirit of Black people of this country, the Azanians. 28th of April, therefore, carries the history, the investments, the sufferings, the contributions, the energies, the sweat, the blood, and everything that was started in 1968, the December of that year. And there and that, the Boers, the white settler colonial regime sought to destroy on the 19th October 1977. Therefore, the 12th of April in 1978 represents the connection between the banned Black Consciousness Movement organization and AZAPO itself post 1977, post that banning. So therefore, the 12th of April represents the carrier date. 12th of April represents the carrying forward of that history that was sought to be banned and destroyed and discontinued, demobilized and immobilized in the survival and the life, the vibrant life of AZAPO. This is a continuation. That is why, therefore, for those who don't understand, we don't only commemorate the 44 years, which should have been on the 28th April 1978. But we go back in time. We go back in time and start at the time at which the enemy tried to erase our history, tried to erase our sufferings, tried to erase the memory of Steve Biko, our sufferings, the Black Consciousness Movement, then 1976 uprising and everything and anything, and then commemorate all those into the continuation date of 28th April 1978. Therefore, we commemorate 54 years of the Black Consciousness Movement. Therefore, the 28th of April is the date of continuation. It is the date of the carrying forward of that history. It is the date of ensuring that the life goes on. The Black Consciousness Movement is here. AZAPO is here. Thank you very much.
Comrade President Qekema, for that introduction, profound introduction indeed, in terms of the evolution of this movement of Biko. Comrade Pandelani Nefolovhodwe, welcome to the platform. At some point, you were arrested as part of the BPC SASO 9, and you went to Robben Island, and you came out, and that SASO BPC trial, it signified a very important epoch in the history of this movement, because it is seen as the defining moment with regard to the actual definition of the philosophy of Black consciousness. It actually gave rise to a lot of things, amongst which was the June 16th, 1976 uprisings. And it most probably propelled the system to, you know, the desire to ban the movement. And the system failed dismally to ban the movement, and thus the Azanian People's Organization. And as we march along, you know, this AZAPO who came out of prison began to distill a different thinking within society. And one of the most important pieces of historical records that exist in this country is the Azanian Manifesto. Azanian Manifesto, which basically spoke to us about the system of racism and capitalism as one of the defining things, you know, that our national liberation is directed against. What is the significance of the Azanian Manifesto in the current political setup?
Thank you for allowing me to be part of this forum, because it's important in one sense that I'm meeting my colleagues who have led the movement in difficult times and who sacrifice all of you who are here in this forum. You are part and parcel of those I'm referring to as those who sacrificed. But to come back to what you wanted me to deal with, you yourself, you have mentioned the significance of the SASO BPC trial. That was very important in the history of the Black Consciousness Movement. Because after the Viva Frelimo rally, the system decided that they were going to annihilate the Black Consciousness Movement. And they came with a strategy of arresting everybody who ever belonged to the movement. If they left out somebody, it was not because they wanted to. It was because maybe they didn't know that that person was part and parcel of the Black Consciousness. But what is important there is that if you can go to the records and see who were arrested, who were these people who were arrested, you will find them today scattered all over the country, in government, in all kinds of formations in our country. They form the sort of a core leadership, which then was indicate how the Black Consciousness Movement had trained cadres to lead the country forward. But significantly, which must be mentioned, is that when we were on that trial or during interrogation, most of us who were interrogated, we were told a story that Steve Biko is not arrested because he's selling out. And we were being pressurized in detention to just forgo our commitment to Black Consciousness on the basis that our leader is working with the status quo and that he is not being arrested as a result of that. But we then defied that because we knew Steve Biko was not that which they were trying to purport. We then brought the chief architect to trial, to come and defend ourselves. And most of the things I'm not going to say is just part of history. But importantly, even before, when he finished delivering his evidence, at the time when he was to leave again to return to King Linastan, we met with him at our normal cell where we are put in order to go to trial. They allowed him to come and join us there. And there we were discussing strategic issues. The question that you normally hear about that Steve Biko was going around trying to convince former liberation movements to act as one. That was discussed by us and Steve Biko. And that was discussed also as a matter of encouragement to say, when we go to Robben Island, Steve Biko, please remain, continue with the duties of carrying out what the movement believed in. So that being the case, that is why Steve Biko was actually now, as I'm talking to you, I can tell you that he was being prepared to be killed. That is why he was omitted from all of us. They were still deciding, what do we do with this dangerous person who has caused so much discomfort to the system? And finally, he was obliterated. But coming to the question of what is it that the Azanian People's Manifesto signifies? The Azanian People's Manifesto actually also, as the president of AZAPO remarks indicated, it's a continuation, absolutely a continuation of the other resolutions that were passed by SASO and those that were passed by the BPC and those that were passed by AZAPO when it was formed. You will remember when AZAPO was formed, the most important thing that was raised there by our comrade Letsatsi Musala was to define the struggle in a classical sense and bring about the classical definition of struggle emanating from the Black Consciousness book. There are many people who confuse what the Black Consciousness movement has written in the Azanian People's Manifesto. They would say no, where the Azanian People's Organization was influenced by Marxists, they were influenced by other people, which is not correct. That was a development and a continuation of the thinking of the Black People Convention and SASO, and as it grows, that is precisely what produced the Azanian People's Manifesto. If you check the documents of the BCMA, for instance, and you compare them even with the Azanian People's Manifesto, and you go to the documents of the BCMA, the main document, you will find that there are there's absolutely no difference with the content of the Azanian People's Manifesto. So it is the way in which the documents were formulated rather than anything else. So I'm just making that very clear, because people tend to think that the ideas that are contained in that document are of foreign origin. That document was produced by the forces that were on the ground. And that was when the Azanian People's Organization was very active in formulating new perspective. Let me leave it there for now. Thank you.
Thank you, Comrade, for your remarks. If you can just unmute for me, thank you. As we move along, Comrade Strike Thokoane, you are the immediate past president of AZAPO. And at the same time, there was a time that you spent in exile, but not in exile. Because, you know, they say you were a member of the BCMA and a soldier in the Azanian National Liberation Army, and you were in exile, but most of your time was spent here in the country as the internal affairs secretary of the BCMA, but also as one of the mshashaphansi of Azanla. Can you just give us your perspective as you reflect back on the Azanian Revolution during the time of the underground. Give us your perspective, of the last many years of struggle in the Azanian Revolution. What do you see? Is this that which we see now reflective of the contribution of the Black consciousness movement in the development of struggle as it was evolving?
Thank you very much, Comrade National Chair, and to all the participants and the people who are here. And also apologize to them that they may not physically or see me in camera because I'm just behind the camera. Reasons I've explained of the gadget one is using at home where I am. But thank you for allowing us to share perspectives of the life we've led, starting from 19, in my case, 72, when I was a student at Morris Isaacson, and then went on to Orlando High, went to Musi High to go and teach, and then to the University of the North with the 1976 uprisings. Now, a lot of people want to paint the uprisings as something that just happened and in 1976. They failed to link it up with the strikes at universities, 1972, the Bao strikes in Durban, worker strikes, the Viva Frelimo rally, the hunger by the Black consciousness movement to get our country free, having seen that it is possible, it can be done with Mozambique and celebrating that freedom. And moving on to the SASO BPC trial, that influenced us so much. Comrade Neff and those who were on the trial may not understand how that trial played an important and pivotal role in mobilizing young people. These trials of Nkutswe Umutsau, the BPC SASO trial that we went to and come back there really motivated. And the only thing we wanted when we came back from there was that we could be given a chance also to participate in that struggle. And June 16 happened. It's another day for me to explain a lot of things because I was also right inside the planning and some of the things that happened, and also took part in the June 16 uprising. I was arrested, of course, for having participated in the group and left the country in 1976. Now, you have mentioned a very painful period of the armed struggle, but which did not start very easy. When we got out to Botswana, to Swaziland, to Lesotho, to Kenya, to the UK, to the US, we're fragmented as members of the Black Consciousness Movement. There were units that were operating as individual units and referring to themselves as being the Black Consciousness units and entities. And the president of AZAPO, opening this webinar, made mention of the 12th of September. That conference that started on the 8th to the 12th of September, I was a delegate to that conference. There's the first national chair, Comrade Basil Manning of the BCMA, who was elected at that conference. It took a resolution a motion that was presented there to say all BCM entities must dissolve and unite into one entity, which is the Black Consciousness Movement of Azania. The name was adopted on the last day. I think that was the last motion, because all along we have been sponsoring or a name sponsored, particularly by Bani Pijani, of the Black Consciousness Movement of South Africa. And when he came there, he came with an agenda of wanting to hijack the organization or capture it to the ANC. And I also think and believe that is why we were allowed to hold that conference in London. Otherwise, had the ANC believed that the outcome of that conference would be the BCMA, I think it would have sabotaged it. But Bani had actually assured them that, no, don't worry, leave it to me. I'm going to bring them into the fold of the ANC. But unfortunately, the day was won by the Black Consciousness Movement of Azania proponents. Fast forward, the military. And because we discussed, as young people, Bokabelo were there, Jairus Khokong were there, to say we needed mature leadership. We needed people who, when they are seen and who have got experience, can come and lead. And Comrade Mangena came, Comrade Khokong came first, and then Comrade Mangena joined the Black Consciousness Movement of Azania in exile. And we're fresh from Congress when they came to join us. Having had meetings with Letsatsi Musala and Ntlobatla immediately after Congress, just to brief them about the outcomes of the Congress, so that we can map out strategies that are similar with what AZAPO is doing inside the country. And also to ascertain and ensure our commitment to working with AZAPO, because AZAPO had been established in 1978. So to actually commit ourselves and ensure to those comrades that we are together all the way. And they helped us to recruit Comrade Mangena to come and into exile. He came out, went through the processes, democratic processes of electing him as the leader, and then started working and emphasizing on issues of armed struggle. I'm sure he can explain much better approaching countries, being promised by Iran to train our people. And before we could do that, a war broke up between Iraq and Iran. And then our program had to be put in abeyance, having to go to Eritrea to talk to the fighting forces there, and then agreeing to train our people. That's where we send Comrade Mutsau and Comrade Mabasa to be our first. So that then catapulted the issue of armed struggle. Mm. Now, just to conclude a little bit, just say a little bit and conclude it.
Yeah,
lots of young people became interested in the armed struggle, and we took a resolution that wherever we are recruiting people and training them. We trained in the mountains of Botswana. We were not allowed to do so, it was illegal. We trained in the houses we were living in. Wherever we were, when we were arrested in prison, we trained people, recruited and trained people. But the most painful one is when we went to the mountains of our country, inside the country, where we actually sat in the caves and never believed we'd come back home. If you had asked me at the point, what is it that I would like to have? I would say if I could just find myself in a proper house, just in a house, because our homes were caves. And then we recruited people. We went up and down. And I remember when I went to Bruderstrom to an Azasim Congress and were working out strategies with them. There were people who were actually plotting to elect me as the president of Azasim at the time, not knowing that actually belonged to the camps in exile. So that is the period, and comrades gave their lives. Mkoseli gave his life. Sean gave his life. I could just mention all the comrades who were with us. They gave their lives, and they did so believing that Azania will be free one day. And if I were to talk to young people today, I would actually tell them about young people who did everything. They left their homes, they left their education, they left their job, they left their wives, they left their girlfriends, everything, so that Akatania should be free. And if we have to go forward, this is the message I would like to give to young people, to say Azania can only be free if and only when we sacrifice for it. Thank you.
Now, thank you, Comrade Strike Thokoane, for your input, and very profoundly so. Dr. Mangena, you led this movement at a very difficult time. You started off leading the BCMA when you were called upon to do so. You were told to leave the country into exile, and you went. And at some point, you then initiated programs towards the military training of our cadres that Comrade Strike was talking about. And then you came back and led our organization, AZAPO, during a very difficult period in its history, a period of merging two organizations with different cultures and traditions, and some say, in the BCMA and the Azanian People's Organization. And we found an organization that then really struggled along, the many years of what we have seen in the country. But, along that, there were poignant contributions that this movement has made. What would, in your view, be those poignant moments that when you sit back and reflect at the contribution of our organization, the contribution of our movement to the Azanian Revolution, and say, aha, that is where this movement has moved the struggle along?
Well, thank you, Comrade Simpiwa, Comrade Chair. Thank you for this event. I wasn't conscious of the fact that it's 54 years since the BC movement came into being. And this invitation brought that fact into focus. As we go along with our work, we do not consciously remember that, by the way, it is this long that we have been in the struggle for freedom under the leadership of this movement, or under the umbrella of this movement. To imagine, you make us focus that some of us were in our early 20s when we started activity in this movement. A unique one, a movement unique in several respects, in the sense that it was formed in order to fill a vacuum that was left by the burning of the other organizations. It seems as though once more, we might be called upon to do something, because there is a vacuum of sorts. The movement that is now in a position of authority or of leadership of the country has abandoned that role in favor of selling out instead of the vacuum that we had in the past that was enforced by bannings. It was a movement that was in a sense a breakaway from white organizations. I don't think there is any other that of organizations that broke away from white trusteeship. That trusteeship, even if you look at it in the context of the student organizations, NUSAS, and the University Christian Movement, which were ideologically blind to the Liberal Party and other parties like that, that thought of themselves as the champions of the freedom of Black people. So this movement broke away and said, we will not be led or lauded by white people who are in fact our oppressors, people who have taken our land. And the ideology that it has adopted of Black consciousness, I think it is one of the seminal moments. If you remember when SASO started in its earlier documents, it was saying, we non-white students of South Africa. And but later it was able to say that, no, we are not non-white students of South Africa. We are Black students of South Africa. This was a great breakthrough psychologically and politically in this country. And that had ushered in a completely new era that had developed the minds, the leadership, the skills of many people who are in leadership positions today in this country. Whether you think of the religious sector, or you think of the business sector, you think of the legal sector, you think of political sector, you think of civil servants, some of whom have retired by now. They were educated by this movement, you know, and it was a movement that was led by young people. And so it succeeded handsomely in conscientizing the population and taking us out of the fear that was induced by the bannings and the arrests and the killings and the hangings of many people who were fighting for freedom through the older liberation movements that were then banned. And so the president and the others, former presidents who have spoken, has spoken about the various flashpoints that had occurred during the operation of this movement, or motivated and influenced by this movement. The 1972 student uprising, it was unknown. I mean, it was huge. To imagine that students from all our bush universities, as they were then called, would abandon their studies and go home and fight in order to ensure that the speech that Tiro had made as their leader, at least at Tefluop, he didn't make it just for himself. He made it for all the students and for all Black people in this country. That is was a very profound moment in the history of the struggle of in this country. And of course, the Viva Frelimo rallies that Comrade Nef spoke about, that focused the minds of our people on the African Revolution as a whole, and also pointed the way and gave voice in the sense that the consequence was the arrest of so many of them who every day of that trial raised their hands and inspired so many people that on a daily basis went to Tshwane to that court in order to give them courage and to say to the world and to everybody, but particularly to the regime, that these are our leaders, these are our people. That was a poignant movement that we had. And of course, the June 1976 uprisings. That would not have happened without the influence of this organization. Comrade Mahauta Malefe, Comrade Mputeng, will tell you about how those students who were imbued with this philosophy would come to the BPC offices to have their pamphlets prepared to strategize about what needs to be done and so on. And so these moments, in my view, were very poignant indeed. And there were also sad moments, of course. The breakaways that occurred after the Tefliop Congress of AZAPO, and that had the effect of staying with us up to this day. But in effect, the movement itself, despite all these difficult moments that and the good moment that has happened, the bad, the good, and so on, it has soldiered on, and it continues to be a factor, if not through representation or through the activities at the political or electoral politics, but its influence remains permanent up to this day.
Thank you, Mangena. Comrade President Qekema, there are two things that if you reflect back at AZAPO that you would agree with me on, that the AZAPO UDF or the UDF AZAPO feud almost annihilated this movement. And then the second moment that I would say it almost crippled this movement was the 1994 election decision. And those two things made life very difficult for the Azanian People's Organization. First, AZAPO had to defend itself against the onslaught of another liberation movement or component of the liberation movement, which wanted to claim the hegemony of struggle to itself. And then came 1994, AZAPO analyzed society and found that, the 1994 election will not, yield anything of significance for Black people. And yet the euphoria of the election moment was just too much for Black people. They were yearning for change and yearning for a freedom that the majority of our people had been fighting for. And yet AZAPO was not there in that election. Here we are now. Reflect back, what made AZAPO to be able to survive these moments?
I think, Chair, we've got to say that particularly Runa as the younger generation of the Black Consciousness Movement, that we are grateful to the ancestors of this movement, both the departed and the living. And then in those ancestors, we think about Steve Biko, we think about Pane Pityana, Mosibudi Mangena, Pandelani Nefolovhodwe, Skupa, and many of those. So we're grateful to them that they have given us this legacy. And it is this legacy that was first attempted to be obliterated or killed, destroyed by the white settler regime. But this movement survived because this movement is made of stellar stuff. This movement survived out of our sheer belief, self-belief, we survived. And so it was that because of the strides that this movement made. Remember that in the early 80s, 1981, 1982, it was this AZAPO that raised the banner of the cultural boycott. It was this movement, this AZAPO, that was able to chase away your OJs, your Kennedys, you name them, all of them. You know, it was this organization. And that vibrancy put us in a position where other organizations began to be jealous of the strides that we were making. And as a result of that, in 1985, you saw a very, very rotten part of the chapter of the struggle where, you know, we had to be chased. Our homes had to be burned, destroyed by fire, because we believed in what we believed in, the Black Consciousness philosophy. Because we raised and defended the legacy of Steve Biko. Some of our comrades were necklaced, killed by the method of putting a burning tire around your neck. And because of all our energies, our resistance, what we believed in, we survived. But I'm saying this because it was tough those days, Comrade Chair. Just remember Comrade Mngomezulu, Comrade Sipho Mngomezulu, who was necklaced. And when he was necklaced, when we went to bury him, and then as we were carrying his coffin, we were then intercepted again, and his coffin was again burned for the second time. So the comrade was burned when he was alive until death, and then burned even when he was already dead. That was the level of political intolerance at that time, but this AZAPO survived all that, and we're here to show that we are continuing. And again, when it came to 1994, this movement, AZAPO, was clear that we were not going to participate in these general elections, because at that point in time, in those elections, we were clear that there was no land there, and we were clear that our wealth as a country was not there. We were clear that in those elections, we were just put there to be able to be the Manjingilanes of the white minority regime that made it a point that the economy was kept in the white hands, and we were going to be there to ensure that that wealth remained in white hands, which is exactly what is happening in this country today. And Black people are still poor. The face of poverty remains Black. But we did not participate. We took the sacrifice. And as a result of that and all of that, this organization, this movement of people struggled a bit, and then was struggling today because we took that sacrifice, that principled position, and we do not regret. And we are continuing right now to re-lionize this movement of Biko. We are one of the few organizations, if not the only, that can survive without money, that can survive with our own funds, our own everything. And we're here today, and we're continuing, and this movement is growing by leaps and bounds.
Thanks, Comrade President Qekema. Comrade Pandelani, you know, there was a time when this movement was known for one thing by many people, the truth, you know, and its insight and ability to analyze society and find answers to problems of society. And everybody has been, you know, whenever there are questions to be asked and people looking for answers, they would look to AZAPO, they would look to, you know, the Black Consciousness Movement for the Black thing, the Black solution. And yet you are here finding this movement battling to connect with Black people. And that has been the problem that most people talk about, that, you know, if you want answers to any Black thing, go to the Azanian People's Organization, and, you know, you will find a solution to, you know, to what we are dealing with. Why has it been so difficult for, you know, this movement to connect with the Black population in the manner in which it should have, considering that it had all the answers to problems that afflict society? What needed to be done differently to enable the movement of Biko to be seen, to be supported by people, considering that we have been participating in elections over the number of years that we have participated?
Thank you for what you have asked. It's very fundamental for me. That's where the core of where we will be going emanates from. Three things, which is making it a little bit difficult for the Black Consciousness Movement to really, really go into a position where it becomes the most important change agent. One, we must all realize that as we are living now in South Africa, we are living under a compromised dispensation. What the publicity secretary of AZAPO refers to as a quasi-democratic system. Now, those who are Marxists, who have learned a bit of Marxism, they call it bourgeois democracy. But the meaning of that bourgeois is what should be explained, because it can just be bourgeois democracy. What is bourgeois democracy? It is a system that actually promotes the capitalist mode of production. It is a system that makes sure that the majority of our people are never in power. They can think they are in power. So we have been given a dispensation through which we must also try to theorize. Even our theories and our solutions are determined by this particular system that we live under. So that's one problem we have, that people were promised a lot of things, and some of the things were given as handouts, and they needed to be conscientized to realize that they must go beyond the compromise, they must go beyond all these handouts. So there are people there who are beginning to realize what AZAPO is saying through experience. Because there was a time where even if you go and tell them that what you have is not what you are supposed to have, they would have told you that no, we trust Mandela and his party. He stayed in prison for so many years. He couldn't come back and give us this dispensation that oppresses us. So sometimes is that people learn from oppression itself so that they can be wiser. The second part of this, which is making it a bit difficult, it's our own deficiency. Our own deficiency lies here, is that for some times, because of bourgeois democracy, we tended to emphasize things like service delivery, because service delivery by itself doesn't make any difference to the concrete conditions of our people. And therefore we are caught up in wanting to show that we will deliver even when we are not in government. And therefore, it makes it a little bit difficult for us to manipulate and get ourselves functional properly. So what is happening is that as a movement, we have lost a little bit of touch of what I normally regard as participation in people's struggles. Participation, not just going into platform and say the good things that you should say, but literally participate. If you check the what has been described by the other comrades, what the movement would do. In the past, this is what the movement must return there quickly, is that when there are matters which relates, say, to the workers, the movement would have put many workers' organizations into that field. The Bamkus, the Bladwas, the Beus, the Bladwas, I can mention a lot of them, so that our people have got forums through which they can participate. Those things were put there despite the fact that AZAPO was in existence. The movement would put advice offices, right, in many parts of the country in order to allow our people to have forums through which they can participate together with AZAPO without AZAPO saying, I'm here as AZAPO. And then you would get Black theology projects so that those who are like me and you who belong to the religious fraternity, they can also go in and interpret the Bible and other things that relate to religion in a forum that deals with that. That was broadening the participation of our people. When there is a strike of young people at high school, there will be the Soweto Action Committee. But that Soweto Action Committee was never named as an AZAPO Action Committee, but it was a Black consciousness. But that is to allow other people who may not necessarily have been card-carrying members of the movement to come in. I don't want to go into that a lot of way. So that is where we must also return to in order to practice Black consciousness in reality, so that it must not become Black consciousness outside the material conditions of our people. The third one, which is so important, is that what we should, what we as we go forward, what is making this touch not to be there is what the president of AZAPO has mentioned. Is that when the enemy comes in to kill you, right? You must look at what is happening in Ukraine.
Yeah.
When the enemy comes to kill you, it leaves you with devastations. It leaves you with doubts. It leaves you with a lot of things. So there was a period when the Congress movement had gone all out to crush AZAPO. And I can tell you now, as I talk to you, that even the security structures of the new government, right? The security structures of the new, the one that you learned later that money used to move up and down in bags, and that no one ever recorded how much was going into that bag or that bag. That was being used also, right, to fund people who must come and crack the Black consciousness movement. And if people don't believe what I'm saying, they must go and read more about the Zondo Commission. So people were there literally to crush the Black consciousness movement. And then when those who were our former liberation movement colleagues went into government, they didn't want to see a Nevis Qekema to to survive. So what they did, they crushed it totally. Now, even now, as I'm talking to you, it is going to be an uphill struggle in order to stand up. And then we need to do other things anew. I always suggest from time to time that we will have to build a formidable movement so that in all corners, in all spheres of our life, so that we can be able to rise. And indeed, we are rising. I mean, I don't need to tell you as leaders of AZAPO now, we are now the backbenchers, right? I don't need to tell you that. I don't need to tell you that everybody can see that the lion is rising. And if we can just make that lion to continue to rise, right? It won't take us 2 years, my comrades. The lion will be what you have asked me to sort of talk about. The lion will be there. And the people of this country will again enjoy that which they enjoyed from the Black Conscious Movement, so that it can lead again at that level, because there is no longer any movement at the moment which is capable of freeing our people. Thank you.
No, thanks for your input, Comrade Nefolovhodwe. Comrade Mangena, you know, yesterday a lot of people were celebrating freedom and, you know, and ushering in of a new era in our country. So, you know, we must celebrate and South Africa is free. But you and I know that, you know, the ANC never fought for freedom. They fought for rights. And, you know, we now have the right to vote and right to, you know, to go to any school. I mean, when you were studying, you had no right to go to Wits University. You had no right to go to the University of Pretoria. You know, the only right you had was to go to the University of Zululand. And now, you know, we can go and vote and do other things. You know, when we look at what is happening now in our country 28 years later, you know, the erosion of, you know, Black dignity, you know, the pit latrines, and just about everything. What do you say to this as a cadre of the Black Consciousness Movement? Is there anything that is worth celebrating? Or is this what AZAPO calls, you know, betrayal of the West order?
Indeed, it is a betrayal, and but it is not a betrayal that we can't do anything about. And incidentally, I do not think that we should not celebrate. I think that we have achieved something as a people. We are no longer being arrested, being harassed, being killed in detention, as our forebears have been, also our colleagues or contemporaries such as Mabetla Mohapi, Steve Biko, Diro, and many others that we know were killed. So it has been an advance. We are no longer where we used to be. And as we sometimes say, the struggle does move in crests and troughs. You have high points and you have got low points. And what has happened now is that our people have been betrayed by people who were saying to them that they were fighting for freedom, when in fact, as you have indicated, they were only fighting for rights. And freedom or liberation and rights are two different things. You can have your civil rights, the right to speak, the right of association, the right to vote, and so on, but not have the actual right to your country as we should have. And so we have, our country has never been in as bad a situation as it is presently, complicated by the fact that the enemy is no longer clear. You know, during the days of settler colonialism, We knew the racists were that side, and we, as the oppressed people, were one side. Now the oppressors look like us. They speak our language and so on. And so it is much, much harder to fight against the settler, neo-colonialism of the type that we have in this country, where people pronouncements are so progressive, at least in the way in which they formulate them. But even then, you know, didn't have the right to go to the University of Zululand. It was a mistake. I was supposed to have gone to Tefloop to be with Comrade Neff and company there, because I'm not Zulu speaking. At the time, we were supposed to go to Sovenga, which was a university for the Sotho, Venda, Shangaan people who were supposed to go there. So it was some streak of rebellion that at the time somehow influenced me, even if I could not articulate it, that influenced me not to go to the University of the North. But we are a tenacious movement. Things had never been the same for us. From inception, we had had a hard time. You'll remember when the movement was first formed, the liberals and others, including other Black people, thought Black consciousness was racist. And some thought that we should not mix with people who of Indian and so-called colored origin. And we soldiered through that, and we managed to bring all these people together. And the many other problems that the comrades have indicated we faced, especially during the days of armed struggle. The tenacity that our young people demonstrated. We were not recognized by most countries, Botswana and so on. We were training, living in the caves, training under very difficult conditions. But the things that made us survive was the connection that we had with our people. We connected. This cadres of Azanla went into the villages in the Northwest, which was Wuputatswana then, and made connection with ordinary people. In Saso, we made connection with ordinary people in the churches, where we went and started classes in literacy, teaching our people to read and write, and in the process, conscientizing them. Saso, through the BCP, went into communities in the Eastern Cape and established clinics, established cottage industries, and so on, and worked with our people. And Comrade Neff was talking about the advice offices. That connection is what we need to intensify in the present period, so that what was achieved by the collective effort of all of us, that is 1994, what was achieved could be transformed into something better. And so, as we had said earlier, we need to go back and connect with our people, not only identify the issues that our people face, articulate them, but be able to work through those issues with our people on the ground. That's where our role should be at present. And that we shouldn't just stand there and criticize what had happened. And incidentally, many of our people had contributed a great deal to bring us where we are now, where some of us were able to leave from exile, come back into the country, where we are able to do the many things that we do, which earlier on we couldn't do. Now, there are problems with land reform or the reconquest of our land, however way you want to put it. There is a problem with our education system. from the kindergarten right up to university. There are problems in health. There are problems with safety of everybody, problem of crime, of especially amongst our children and women in our country. There are problems with the drugs. The BC that we come from would be going into our communities to confront these problems head on. After all, what is liberation? Liberation is the ability of a people to own their own lives, their resources, their country, their land, and so on. And if they don't, then there is a problem. So we should be ensuring that there are no drugs that are killing our youngsters. In every community that you go into in our country now, I can tell you about Polokwane where I am now, the problem is huge. We are losing young people to drugs. They are being destroyed by this scourge. And so we can go and we don't own our land, we don't own our economy, and so on. And I'll be saying that we, as members of this organization, should be going into our communities to confront these issues together with them. Not only theorizing, identifying them, articulating what they mean, and so on, but we should be working with our people at the theoretical and practical level to solve these issues.
Thanks, Comrade Mosibudi Mangena, the former president of AZAPO. Comrade President Qekema, you have been talking to us about a new AZAPO. You have been talking about a relionizing AZAPO. Can you explain to us what is the meaning of this thing? When you say, you know, AZAPO must be relionized, what are you talking about? You know, a lot of people are at AZAPO and talking about AZAPO as this intellectual giant. And there were people who were saying, maybe AZAPO should just fold and become a research group instead of continuing to be a component of the liberation movement. Largely people are not maybe au fait with the contribution that this movement has made. People are not remembering that this used to be an action organization. You spoke earlier about the contribution of this movement to the consumer, to the cultural boycott. You spoke about the contribution of this movement to the emergence of the June 16 uprisings. And you've been talking about, you know, an organization that was always in action. Now you're saying we must relionize. Relionize, what does that mean? And once relionized, what then, to what end? What do you want this organization to achieve? Where are you taking this AZAPO?
Thank you, Chair. First of all, we have to realize and understand and never forget it, that the Black Consciousness Movement is the movement of the revival of the struggle. Remember that when the older liberation movements were banned in 1916, and then historians are saying there was a lull, a political lull in the country, and everyone was too scared to talk about the struggle and anything related to the struggle. And at that point in time, a lot of the leaders of the older liberation movement left this country and skipped the country. And the people were left almost leaderless because everyone was too scared. And this Black Consciousness Movement, young people, teenagers, were the one who sprang to their feet and said, the torch of the struggle can never be dim. That light must be lighted again. And then we did that, this movement. It is this movement, you know, that was able, you know, to snatch the struggle from the hands of the white liberals, you who were telling us and thinking us and talking for us and even running for us, doing everything for Black people. And it is this movement that said, that must stop. We take over, we're gonna be self-reliant, self-initiative, self-assertive. We are our own liberators as Black people. It is this movement. It is this movement that brought about, you know, the 1976 uprisings. And so it is this movement that we must make sure that never dies. That is why we are therefore saying, as AZAPO today, that we recognize that at some stage, we started to punch below our weight, we started to run slower, and then we started to whisper when we speak, and then we are saying now the time has come to re-lionize and be the lions again. In short, what we are saying, therefore, is we are saying that the contributions and sacrifices of Steve Biko, Bani Pityana, Mosibudi Mangena, Nkgopotse Tiro, Pandelani Nefolovhodwe, and everyone else, June 16 uprising, must never be erased. We must be able to compensate those sacrifices by saying that Black consciousness must be mainstreamed. It must be in governance, it must be in academia, it must be in every sphere of life of this country. And that can happen if AZAPO, the custodian of Biko and Black consciousness, is re-lionized, re-sharpened again, so that it is able to be what it ought to be to ensure that the land returns to its own rightful owners, so that our dignity and humanity as Black people is restored through the leadership of AZAPO.
Hmm. So you effectively want our humanity to be restored through AZAPO, and that humanity can only be restored if we have our land back. You know, the interesting thing is that AZAPO has always said, you know, we must fight for our land. We are participants in this parliamentary setup. How do you see AZAPO spearheading a program of the return of the land through that parliamentary process?
First of all, you will see why it is that nobody else can do the job of liberating Black people and this country other than AZAPO, which should be and is in fact re-lionizing. Just 2 days ago, the ruling party was going cap in hand, talking to white farmers who stole our farms, our land and everything. You know, our food security, is in their hands, everything. They stole it, and we've got nothing. You know, poverty, nothing. Yet, the people who we have given power in their hands to use as an instrument to redistribute that wealth, to reclaim our land, what are they saying? 2 days ago, they were saying to the white farmers, please, can you please help us? And then can you go and find if you don't have some unused or useless land and then give it to the Black people who have been displaced by the inclement weather in KZN? Oh my God, how can that happen? That is why you need AZAPO. And in AZAPO, we know that land cannot be reclaimed through and through only parliament. But that is why we are saying you've got to also be able to work with the people in the villages and the townships and wage a struggle from below and outside parliament. And then you use the two arms to go together.
You know, just a question for the three of you. We have lost Comrade Strike Thokoane, the immediate past president of AZAPO, and we are hoping to reconnect with him shortly. We still have the current president of AZAPO, Comrade Nelvis Qekema, Comrade Mosibudi Mangena, and Comrade Pandelani Nefolovhodwe, our two former presidents. And what I'd like to ask the three of you is, if you look at the country right now, and we've seen what is happening with the conflict, I'm not sure if you'd call it a conflict, that has given rise to our people being unhappy with people from neighboring countries in Africa, and they see them as foreigners who have come to occupy their space and to occupy their economic activity and to do things that ought to take up employment that ought to have been given to our nationals. We have seen other people saying, well, I have listened, for instance, on radio a couple of days ago, people talking about, this freedom, saying this freedom is for those who were in the liberation struggle and it is not for us young people. Young people have rejected this, and young people are saying, they feel they have been sold out. They don't feel liberated. Their feeling is that this country is ripe for another revolution. Where do we place AZAPO in this, starting with Comrade Pandelani Nefolovhodwe? Is AZAPO ready for the second revolution?
Yeah, thank you for that also. This is also very crucial. Is that when the young generation says they've been sold out, they are correct. There's no doubt in my mind that the young generation has been sold out. All what they are saying is that you, the older generation, wherever you were, you came to us, young as we are, and made a lot of promises for things you did not actually deliver. And that now we see through that you have lied to us. And even me, who come from that generation, I can see that the younger generation has been lied to. One of the biggest lies was that if you go to school and pass all your subjects, despite the fact that even the pass mark is so low that the kind of education you acquire there is of no consequence. You can be an engineer who do not even know how to build a road. So you become certificated. And even with that promise, nothing is happening because people gave our youngsters a false hope to say, if you go to school, go to university, we will give you money to go through that university education. When you finish, everything will be okay. And that is why the Black Consciousness Movement is so fundamental, because it goes to the level of self-reliance, that even when you have your own education, you shouldn't think that everything will just be dished to you. But yesterday here, I had another fellow talking about the fact that when you go to school and after passing, you have got to be given a graduate grant. Now, so people owe you something for having gone to school. So when you finish school and there are no jobs and you have got knowledge to create jobs, you must be given a grant and stay at home. So it is the mentality of our country. The mentality needs that Black Consciousness Movement, because that mentality, it's not doing any service to our people. And that is where our people lose dignity. The dignity of our people get lost there, where they think everything must just be given to them anytime. But it is because of the governing party. The governing party has brought a wrong mentality altogether. about governing, about our youngsters. They think, for if you join a particular ruling party, you will automatically be having money. Money will be dished to you. And indeed, if you have noticed, in some of their meetings, money is dished out. And therefore, how do you expect a young fellow to grow up knowing how things are? Because they only know that if you join and you become a cadre and you do what you are told, and next time there might be a 1,000 which is given to you anytime you go to the meeting, of course, including beer. So, but this is the crux of our country. Our country has gone so low, even with morale. There is no longer anything called morale. There are no people. In fact, I think we made a mistake, we from the Black Consciousness Movement, to have maintained that most of the people who come from the ruling party are liberation struggle veterans. Because they are liberation struggle veteran by name, because that veteran of the liberation struggle has been erased in their heads. For instance, I'll give you an example. If you look at them, they went into government and literally owned the whole state. It belongs to them. Bona Havana, they don't have a problem, because if you want to be an ambassador, right, you have to be deployed by them to become an ambassador of your own country. And if you can go and count how many ambassadors are not of the African National Congress. So they had gone to capture, they went to capture all the affairs of the state and put their own people so that they control everything. They went into destroying things like ESCOM. So these things are very important. That the Black Consciousness Move must connect with the communities, must be there in order to explain. You must remember that what is called generally, colloquially, ordinary people, their biggest disadvantage is that they normally don't sit down because of the status in society to theorize. They don't sit down and theorize. They don't sit down and put ideas together for whatever reason. They just know what they know. Mm. And for us who theorize, therefore, for us who now theorize, we need to be there with them to be able to discover what they know. Because we will also not discover, because they don't theorize and write, and so that we can read. So until that connection is there, as Comrade Mangena was saying, if it is not there, even our theories will be hogwash theories, because we won't be able to articulate what is in communities. So this is an area which makes some of us very worried about how we have degenerated into something which is really bad. Now, coming to the matter regarding foreign nationals, any self-loving country, any, it doesn't matter which one, must have rules of who comes in the country and who goes out. Under what circumstances will we allow people to stay with us? And under what circumstances we will allow. Even at my home, you can't just come and enter my home. We check. We say, well, that one is a relative. Those are rules that pertains to every country. But one thing that we must know is that migration will not stop. Migration is always there, all over the world. So it has to have control measures. One time when I was still at the Pan-African Parliament, I used to sit in that committee of migration. And we came to the conclusion that, no, in order to be able to control migration in Africa, there must be a treaty which is done by all the African countries, wherein we know how to talk to each other. If I have people who all of a sudden have come to my country and I do not know how to handle them. And it was agreed that SADC will have some rules, ECOWAS will have some rules, Jalo Jalo in terms of the regions. But when you look at it, South Africa, through our brothers who are ruling it, they just left it. It's free for all. You must just leave every. So when ordinary people are living in poverty and are living in circumstances they are not getting what they are supposed to get, the first thing they rely upon is their material, immediate material circumstances. So they look around where they stay and they start fighting for those spaces that makes them to survive. There is no single individual, you must know, who can allow himself to disappear completely, to be dead, when he can or she can see that there are places where can do a zama-zama even by stealing. The problem is just that you don't have control in our country. That department, which is called Home Affairs, you must just forget about it. Because we shouldn't teach our people also that they must hate people who come from the continent simply because they don't stay within their own geographical space. Mm. All what we must do, if we are a good government, we have to control. Control measures have to be put in place. If you had listened to Minister Mutshwane, he just started last week to want to bring about control. For 27 years, 28 years, he didn't think that we will have to have control. So the shortest of your question, answer to your question is that there must be rules and control so that people can be able to be controlled where they stay, where they don't stay. And if you come for asylum, there are rules also which are accepted even by the United Nations. Then we place you through the asylum process. If you are a group, we deal with you, send you to jail. If you have crossed by chance without obeying our rules, we send you where you come from. So that's really simple matter. But you have to have control. Thank you very much.
No, thank you. Thank you, Nefolovhodwe. Comrade Strike, thank you for coming back. I'm sure you were listening to the conversation. You have views about what I was talking about. Where do you see us going as a country? Are you seeing another revolution emerging, or are you seeing the country just continuing with as usual?
Well, a people that is oppressed will end up with a situation where they realize that things are not going right. And of necessity, they will rise at some point. We used to say, when we discuss about what the ANC was doing in exile, because a lot of people think they are a glorious movement of Nelson Mandela and Oliver Tambo, which was good all the way. These things they are doing, they're not new. We have seen them do these things when we are with them in the camp and everywhere else in exile. They've just been doing this. And amongst ourselves, we used to say, if these guys take over, they are going to take back our struggle 100 years. And we just mentioned that figure, but without doing any scientific calculations. But what we believe that things are going to go back a number of years. The gains that our people have made are going to be reversed so many 10 times, 20 times fold. So we were not surprised. We're not shocked that they are doing this. But what is worse is that the back of the potato is getting rotten every day. Even when they speak of renewal, there is no renewal. It is renewal so that they can be voted back into office or into power they are holding. But basically, there is no renewal whatsoever. And this is going to lead to a point where our people must mobilize. And AZAPO must find itself there. Because at the moment, the powers that be have also created these other organizations that are sponsored with lots and lots of money. I mean, look at the leadership of the EFF. Look at the kind of cars they're driving. All of them, they've got expensive cars. The entire leadership, in the national, in the province, in the region, everywhere, when you are a leader, immediately you are awash with resources, cash, to spend. I also think that your Dudula movement is the same thing that has been created so that they can blind and mislead our young people especially. And Comrade Nelvis talking about people wanting to be paid to do this or that, so that this revolution can be delayed further and further and further. But it cannot go unnoticed. It cannot go ad infinitum. At some point, our people are going to see this, and they need a vanguard movement like AZAPO to mobilize them so that the struggle can further be redirected. It may not happen in the lifetime of some of us, but the tree must be planted now, so that in the next so many years to come, when they germinate and they give out the flower, whatever, they must give out something that is revolution. So to answer your questions directly, I want to say it will not be the end of revolution. Revolution is a science. Struggle is a science. It will not be the end of it. At some point, something will emerge and people are going to fight and struggle and suffer and sacrifice for their revolution. That is coming, but we must be in the thick of things. Whatever we do, we must plan to mobilize for those seeds and plant those seeds so that in time our people can rise.
Thank you, Comrade Strike. And Dr. Mangen, your views on this, should we begin to see Black people seeing the ANC as the enemy of the people and mobilizing themselves into a revolution against the leadership of the ANC?
Oh, it will happen because as all of us have been saying, this country is a mess. And there are very few people who are satisfied with what is occurring in this country. And if young people believe that they've been sold out, they are not alone. All of us believe that we've been sold out. And you can see the levels of dissatisfaction that has crept into society as a whole in this country. For different reasons, the rich, the whites, and so on are unhappy for their own reasons. But the vast majority of people who are poor, who are ordinary, are desperate for it.
Yeah. It looks like you're muted there.
You don't hear me.
I can hear you now. You're back.
Yes. But the revolution needs to be worked for. And if it is allowed to take place on its own spontaneously, it might just lead to anarchy. That will not be to the benefit of anyone. You will have a Somalia where they overthrew Siad Barre, but they don't have any country to speak of. It's chaos. And that is not a revolution that we want. So in order to have a proper revolution, it needs to have a vanguard, a party that will guide that revolution in the right direction. That's why we should be in every village, in every township, in every place in this country, so that we are with our people and we are able to guide that revolution. And we are able to tell when the conditions are right. You remember, in order to have a chief, you must have conditions that are suitable both inside and outside for that revolution. For the chicken must come and sit on an egg that inside is not rotten, it's proper. And then it provides the necessary temperature, and in a number of the allotted number of days, a chick will come out. Now, even with the revolution, if it just comes off out of unguided anger, it might lead to a failed state, might lead to anarchy that does not benefit anybody. So this regime now that we have is failing in every respect, including the one that we've just been discussing about foreign nationals. And in my view, I think that they are in fact through their behavior sabotaging the integration of our continent, because they are causing unnecessary strife amongst different people through their lack of organization. Those of us who have been in exile, Comrade Strike will tell you, and I suppose Comrade Neff, who had also gone to Zimbabwe, will tell you how they control us, how he, as a visitor there, coming to consult with the BCMA, that is in his capacity as a leader in AZAPO, how he was controlled, how he was managed until he left that country. So there is no problem that our people have with foreign nationals, especially their African brothers and sisters. It is this regime that is causing that situation to develop. But comrades, let us prepare for that revolution. And if the revolution doesn't come, we should be in a position to lead society peacefully and legally to a point where our people will feel that this country belongs to them, that they are empowered, that they have got land, that their education is proper, that their health is proper, that they are safe, and so on. And that you can achieve through the parliamentary processes, because if parliamentary processes are proper, then an AZAPO takes over, it can, through legal processes, ensure that all these things are changed, that people have got land and so on, you expropriate or you reconquer or you take back your country. Because if we focus only on one aspect, that is a revolution, and the revolution does not materialize because the conditions do not allow it to take place at a given time, then we lose all round.
Mm. President Qekema, are we ready for an Azania Spring?
Oh yes, we are ready for that spring. In fact, it is even better that it is an Azanian umzabalazo, because we've seen what happens to springs. Sometimes, sometimes springs easily spring out of control and out of action and out of life. Now, I've heard you talking about whether is there an opportunity for a second revolution. I take the line that says no. There is no second revolution to talk about. We are talking about the same revolution because the revolution is permanent. This revolution is continuing. The revolution of yesterday is the revolution of today, and it will be the revolution of tomorrow. It is continuing, a luta continua, and what the difference is that every revolution, sometimes it is active, sometimes it is dormant, sometimes it is moving at a high tempo, sometimes mid or low tempo, but it is the same revolution because it is permanent. That is why in AZAPO, we don't have terminology like post-colonial state, because for us, this is a neo-colonial state. But coming to the point about whether what is happening between the strife that is happening amongst our people, there, we think that the problem is this. We must understand that first of all, in the continent, the nation states and the demarcation of those states was a creation and imposition of the imperial forces, the colonial forces. And so therefore, Africa as a continent was microwaved into nation states. But are we going to deny the fact that we now have nation states? I think we can't. AZAPO believes we cannot, because states are now here. And so therefore, we need to operate as of now within those states. Otherwise, if you deny that, there will be chaos. Because the question would be, if you simply say we reject the states because they're a creation of the colonial powers, what will you be left with? One continent, which is a continent, but a continent that is made out of no states. But what will happen to the boundaries and things? You destroy them. What will be the movement, and who will be controlling that, and who will be ruling that, and what model will that be? And so therefore, we are saying, as of now, you will need the states, because the states are there so that there is order. But then when it comes to the fact that there are people of ours, Africans who are coming from the neighboring African states to be here because of poverty and all the other things, that needs to be controlled, the rules that we're talking about, because we are a country, we are a state, we have a government. You know, so therefore there need to be rules. How do you deal with that? You know, the immigration rules that we are talking about. In fact, the problem, as it has been explained, it is because we are having a sterile state, an impotent state that has not been able, you know, to implement those rules and those laws. And as a result of that, we're now having the poor people fighting amongst themselves because they now have to compete, you know, for little jobs here and there, little space here and there, little bread here and there, little food parcels that is dropped from time to time here and there. But the issue that AZAPO is raising is that this should not be the problem. We should not be fighting amongst ourselves. We should not be fighting to be laborers. We should, in fact, be fighting to be the owners of the factories, owners of the land, the owners of the wealth itself, so that we distribute that wealth ourselves, to ourselves as a nation and as a people. So therefore, AZAPO is saying, we should be talking to organizations like Dudula so that we sit down with them and say, we hear you, but can we sit down and talk? Is it right that you have the plight that you're talking about that you think should drive you to fighting and chasing and displacing other African people? In AZAPO, we think that is not the way to do things. We think that the state must be forced to do what it is supposed to do, the order that needs to be there. We should not be in the game of self-blame, mea culpa, as Steve Biko said, but we should be able to be an orderly people.
Thank you, President Qekema. President Strike Thokoane, your closing comments?
Hey, sorry, I missed a lot of what the other speakers have said after Comrade Mangena. But I think, in closing, there's a need to strengthen our organization. These things that we are talking about of wanting to become a federal will not just happen. They will happen when our organization is strengthened. If I have to be inward looking, I can say from 1994, immediately after that, we found our organization in different little pockets of splinters. And we spent lots of time, resources and all, in trying to build an entity that is a very, very united and strong AZAPO. I think we must not abandon that journey. We must find a way to strengthen the organization. I was looking at the list of the people who are participants this evening. And fortunately, I am in a position to know and have worked as an organizer in this organization with most of them, even those who are outside the country. But also a number of AZAPO people who are sitting somewhere and not becoming a player in the game they're supposed to be playing. Instead, they are just spectators. All these people need to be mobilized. Their morale must be raised. Their belief in the struggle and revolution must be rekindled and be mobilized into making an input in our organization so that the knowledge that they have, the consciousness that they were given by this organization should actually now come to play. But more than anything else, this organization must go and recruit young people. We must get them as early as 12, 13, 14 years. So that, because that's where things start. If we get them late, they've already subscribed and put themselves in organizations that are not actually interested in the revolution of our people. So we need to go and get young people. We must get mobilized women and conscientize them in accordance, again, to the dictates of the present political climate paradigm. They must be able to have, you see, I was at the Azanla NVA meeting in Durban 2 weeks ago, where the president addressed them. And you could see these guys are becoming old. And when I looked at them, I said, the things that they could not do 20 years, 10 years, 5 years ago, I don't see these guys doing them going forward. So there is need to renew and rekindle our organization, get new people before this layer of membership and leadership disappears. But they must not disappear with what they have. Leave what they have with the next generation so that the struggle can be taken forward. I think even when we go out to go and recruit, it's important that our organizations of young people must be re-established in universities, in the townships, in churches, and everywhere where our people are, so that they can be able to contend with the others who are misleading our people. Thank you.
Thank you, President Thokoane. President Nefolovhodwe, your closing comments.
Let me unmute. My closing comment really is to hammer on what Comrade Mangena said earlier on. We should be everywhere. We should be at village, to every village, and we must be at all the township, and we must have linkages with our people. Our people must feel that the ideas of AZAPO are their ideas, which means they must participate. We must make it easier for them to participate so that they can be also part and parcel of developing new ideas that will lead this movement towards their own freedom. So if we can just master the question of village to village, township to township, and cover as many areas of our country as possible, we shall have done a good service to ourselves. But when we do that, it means our leadership, Comrade President, we must start having people who are taught how to recruit and how to make members to participate and how to retain members. We mustn't take for granted, Comrade President, that because some of them we know, they grow up in our movement and therefore they know that tactic. It's a very important tactic that we've got to have time to teach, and we can have a way in which we identify people who can do exactly that so that we can have effectiveness in recruiting, so we can have numbers that we have of trained cadres. Every revolution, in fact, has got, when you say there must be a vanguard, you are meaning that you have the most trained and the other layer and the other layer, so that those layers, they perpetuate your struggle even when the other layers are us now, who are the old generation. So that's what I would want just to leave you with as my leaders, to say, if we can concentrate at recruitment and teaching people how to recruit, but we must do it everywhere, from village to village, township to township, we shall be very, very far. And the secondly, let's create platforms. You see, when I'm a Christian and I'm a Roman Catholic Church member, and my brother is a Seventh-day Adventist, and the other brother is an Anglican, right? They all believe in one thing, but they attend different churches because there are certain rituals that they don't like from each other, but they are in one family. And let AZAPO do exactly that, create platforms where people can participate in the BC philosophy without having all of them club together every day, every time, it will really work. And that is why, in fact, there were 17 to 18 organizations which were banned. And those organizations were all part and parcel of the same direction, same outlook, same philosophy, but they operated from different platforms. When I'm a journalist, I want to toy and sing about journalism, whilst actually someone might not feel happy to do that. But I still belong to the Black Consciousness Movement. And I like the posture you have extended, Comrade President. I must say so, because when I like things, I openly say so. The letter you wrote, a directive you wrote just recently, when you noticed that our people will be distracted, and you wrote very clearly, hey, don't be distracted. Here is focus. Let's focus on that price we want. And I just hope that many people have read, and we must hammer it again and again, because we got distracted, as the comrade Strike was saying. We sort of got distracted after we had our own internal conflicts, and we didn't go and read properly other books about internal and external contradictions. And some of the internal contradictions, we ended up seeing them as if they are external contradictions. So, Comrade President, thank you very much for that directive, because that's where people must be taught that it doesn't mean that they must not differ, they must not argue, but there are those contradictions that are easy. And if we can focus on that, we will be very far. Another thing that, I'll phone for the what I wanted to say, I will be out of order here.
Thank you, President Nefolovhodwe. President Mangena.
Well, thank you very much. The comrades have said it all, so I'll be very brief. We have analyzed the situation in our country. It is dire, and we are not going anywhere except south. We are going down as a people, as a country, in terms of the material conditions under which we live. You can go to every aspect of our lives. You'll come back with the same diagnosis. We have done that. And so what we need to do now is to prepare to take the country to another level. And as we can only do that, we organize in the Pan-African Congress. That is it's not the PAC of Azania, but the continental one. We used to say, I belong to that, we used to say that don't agonize. That was a slogan written at the bottom of the letterhead. And in all the publications, the slogan was there, don't agonize, organize. So let's stop agonizing. Let's not stop talking about it. Let us go and organize. And it is only through organization that all these things that we're talking about, connection with our people, can only come through organization, being present in the villages, in the townships, in the communities, and being able to talk to all layers of our society, all aspects, whether people are in the higher education sector, they are in the general education sector, whether people are in health, whether people are in the religious sector. We should be able to connect with our people, but we can only do that if we are in, we have got structures that are able to interact with our people at every level. When they don't have water, we must not have water, and we must be able to talk to them about that and about how we resolve and solve that problem. So let us not agonize, let us organize.
Thank you, President Mangena. President Qekema, your closing statement.
Thank you very much, Chair. Chair, there is no doubt in our minds. We are very, 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 very deliberate about what we are doing in building AZAPO brick by brick. And we're out to make Steve Biko, Nkgopotse Tiro very proud. We are out to make Strini Modli, Abu Bakar Asfat very, very proud in such a manner that they must feel wherever they are in their grave that they never died in vain. And in doing so, that's the reason why we're out and out to make AZAPO an action-oriented organization, because we want to make AZAPO a contender for power. And we're deliberate when we say, and we mean it, come 2024, AZAPO has got to be, it ought to be, and there is in parliament and in every legislature in this country, there is the reason why already we've started to make it a point that there is no, not even one by-elections goes by without AZAPO participating. We're participating in everyone. And that we are saying we're making AZAPO an organization of choice for our people. We are building AZAPO into a weapon and a shield for Black people. And then we are also saying, in doing this, there is no doubt in our mind that we are turning the corner. That is why, right from a December last year when this leadership was elected, you must have seen that almost every week AZAPO is on the news, either on the radio or television or in the newspapers, not for anything, but because it is doing action in the villages and in the township. That is why AZAPO is storming the courts of law in defense of the struggle heritage and saying, nobody is going to tell us, instruct us not to sing a Dulibur, we shall sing it. And that is why just this past weekend, we are seeing in the Free State, our comrades are out there not sleeping, Arrive Alive campaign. You are seeing in Limpopo, Eastern Cape, Northwest, Western Cape, everywhere, almost every week, AZAPO is hitting the ground, is on the street out there, raising their placards, marching and singing and fighting on the side of Black people, because AZAPO shall not be the same. We believe in this AZAPO. AZAPO that we are leading is going to be what it ought to be. And then watch this space.
Thank you to my presidents, President Strike Thokoane, President Pandelani, Nefolovhodwe, Comrade President Mosibudi Mangena, and Comrade my President Nelvis Qekema for a beautiful conversation this evening. We were reflecting on the 54 years of existence of the Black Consciousness Movement and its contribution to the Azanian Revolution. And we do want to see you joining this revolution. As the president has indicated, the revolution is permanent and our freedom is still to be attained. We want every Black person joining the bandwagon of the revolution. And let's meet again on Sunday as we continue these discussions. On Sunday, we are talking about immigration policies and practices in South Africa. Are they bad policies or it is just a question of inept government? On the podium, on the platform at the time, 1:30 on Sunday, will be Comrade Mark Mfikwe, my colleague in the Standing Committee of AZAPO. Along with him will be Comrade Dr. Thierry Chinyoka. They will be dissecting this topic for us and helping us understand the problem of immigration policies in our country, whether that is the problem or the government is the problem. Thank you for joining us, and we look forward to having you again on Sunday afternoon. Thank you.
tears.